McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Winning with Underdogs. How hiring the least likely candidates can spark creativity, improve service, and boost profits for your business. By Gil Winch, PhD, narrated by Jonathan Cowley. Introduction. Most people don't realize how close we actually are to socially transforming our world. At long last, we've arrived at this unique time in human history where technology, a camera in each hand, and social media afford us the opportunity to substantially reduce social injustice around the globe. Traditional and social media drag various social injustices out of the shadows, with our smartphones providing dramatic live footage of daily bias, discrimination, and prejudice, laying them bare for all to see. We can no longer pretend that inequality isn't widespread and deep-rooted. Seeing it with our own eyes wakes us up, galvanizes us, and hardens our resolve, pushing many of us to fight for changes in our society. We post, we shout, and we protest in the streets. National and global public sentiment is ripe for a historical collective push towards social justice and real equality. Yet, despite our intentions, I fear that we might not achieve the changes for which we're fighting. I've been an organizational psychologist for 35 years, and the long duration of my career has offered me diverse experiences. I've worked with a variety of industries, such as finance, retail, manufacturing, and high tech, and with top security clearance required governmental entities. I've worked within all levels of an organization, from entry level to C-suite employees, and I've served as the personal consultant to Israel's chief of police, industry leaders, and heads of large organizations. I've also given keynotes and workshops to business leaders and executives from over 70 countries. Among these industries, corporations, cultures, and nations, I've observed a single overarching similarity. Marginalized populations are in general underrepresented or disadvantaged in the workforce, and some populations are practically absent from it, regardless of where you are in the world. This global phenomenon of workplace exclusion seems to follow similar rules of thumb across nations. And it's not just marginalized populations and small fringe groups who suffer continued workplace inequality. It's shockingly most of the globe's population when you do the math. In the United States, Black and Hispanic people represent 32% of the population, but suffer significantly higher levels of unemployment than white people. Moreover, according to the US Federal Reserve, the typical white family has 8 times the wealth of the typical Black family and 5 times the wealth of the typical Hispanic family. Perhaps more astonishing, women, half of the global population, are paid less than men in every country on the planet. The global gender parity gap in 2020 was at 31.4%. Founded in 1903 in the United Kingdom by Emmeline Pankhurst, the suffragettes fought for women's right to vote. It took 25 years of protests, hunger strikes, and thousands of incarcerations to win that basic right. But bias and bigotry toward women continues 80 years later, as women have yet to achieve equal opportunities and wages, and they are, still, sexually harassed with shocking frequency. In a recent survey, 81% of women reported experiencing sexual harassment in their lifetime. Over 50 years ago, 1 million people marched with Martin Luther King Jr. for racial justice and equality. Yet after all that time and effort, Black people are regularly shot and victimized just because of the color of their skin. Minority men's rate of board representation in the Fortune 500 grew at less than 0.5% per year from 2010 to 2020. African American / Black men lost 1 seat in the Fortune 100 and 5 seats in the Fortune 500. Despite the growing public outcry, Something hasn't fully worked with our prolonged attempts to end social injustice, and it doesn't seem to be lack of motivation or caring. People are active and vocal, and many who were quiet in the past are quiet no more. Women, people of color, and other groups that are fighting for social justice actually constitute a large majority in the United States. If such a large majority of people deeply desire a change that is not only just and honorable, but also greatly beneficial to all, and is a change that has few detractors, as we shall see, why are we still fighting for it? Why hasn't it happened already? What is holding back the change? Apparently, we seem to be missing something, overlooking something, neglecting something crucial. Indeed, we are, and I want to explain what I think that something is. It's corporate America. It's businesses. It's our workplaces. Social justice needs to start there. The workplace is where people from all walks of life meet, strive to move ahead, endeavor to provide for their loved ones, and hope to afford themselves and their families a better life. Those are the natural and widespread motivations and dreams of most individuals in a capitalist society, and employed adults spend most of their waking hours at their workplace pursuing them. For most adults, the workplace represents the focal point of our time, the doorway to our aspirations, and the place we go to provide for our daily needs. The modern-day workplace is a powerful entity indeed. According to a 2021 survey, 66% of employees have experienced workplace bullying. Yet our workplaces are currently hotbeds of social injustice and widespread exclusion. Some of the data I'll present is indeed staggering. Many large corporations actively conceal their exclusion of various groups and minorities while publishing glowing articles and reports touting the importance of diversity, equity and inclusion, DE&I, and their own commitment to full inclusion and social justice. I'll introduce data proving that in the modern-day workplace, too many marginalized groups are underrepresented and often disadvantaged simply because they belong to a non-mainstream group, people of color, people with disabilities, ex-convicts, older people, shy and anxious people, various minorities, and so on, and because of our many biases. If you believe that you are immune from such disregard, give it time. Given that age is one of the causes of employment marginalization, most of us will join the employment underdog ranks eventually, and sadly, many of us will not have to wait until later in life to do so. During the span of our work life, countless people will experience periods during which our self-confidence and self-efficacy dip and our anxiety peaks, and for some of us, unemployment will become chronic. It's so regrettable that the workplace has been largely neglected in our voiced outrage and cries for equality because it is such a crucial venue when attempting to deal with social injustice. Most of us experience and witness exclusion and prejudice at our workplaces, but often we dismiss or disregard such occurrences for various reasons. We are hesitant to make a fuss or tangle with a superior because such actions could have ominous consequences to our own job. But we also tend to view ourselves as good and honorable people, and we would like to see ourselves acting with integrity in the face of social injustice. Faced with an incongruence between our inactions and our values and self-beliefs, our psyche often resolves such inner conflicts and discrepancies by interpreting the offending incident as insignificant, minor, or someone just having a bad day, thus reducing its potency in our mind's eye and keeping our integrity complete. At times, our subconscious will protect us by not even noticing troubling events, by glossing over them altogether. Alas, by subconsciously allowing ourselves to put up with such incidents at one place, we render our efforts to eliminate them elsewhere psychologically weaker and lacking in resolve. believing, subconsciously or otherwise, that we are powerless to change upsetting injustices in the workplace saps our will and strength to fight them in general, and it allows the exclusion of many of our brothers and sisters to continue. We should turn our collective gaze toward the workplace, not just because of its importance in the greater fight for equality and social justice, and not just because its cruel exclusion of various groups must end. We should turn our collective gaze toward bringing social justice to the workplace because it's so beneficial to us all. Any society that maximizes its resources and production capabilities will have greater combined wealth, because when more unemployed people join the workforce and become contributing and productive members of an economy, that economy grows and becomes richer. If all non-institutionalized adults in the United States had a job, a stat called U6, which is the most accurate stat regarding the growth potential of a workforce, the US national workforce would grow by 10% on average. That's an additional 15 to 16 million jobs added, which would turbo boost the national economy, significantly improving the conditions and wealth of every household in the country. It goes without saying that it would greatly affect the lives of those 15 to 16 million new employees and their families, transforming them from the unwanted status of dependents to proud contributing assets. Full inclusion can create financial benefits that are no less than dramatic, not only for the nation as a whole, but also for corporate America and large companies alike, which we will detail in Chapter 1. For both our communities and for businesses, the benefits of full inclusion are similarly profound. Last but not least, for our employment-deprived brothers and sisters, the employment underdogs themselves, as we shall see, the difference between chronic unemployment and a steady job is literally life-changing and at times even life-saving. Because of its profound importance to us and because of the huge potential gains to all, the workplace must become the key arena to achieve real social justice, true acceptance, and equality. We deserve to go to work among people who differ from ourselves, people who represent the real diversity of our communities. We deserve to exchange the fears that such differences currently evoke with comfort in the understanding that those members of our community who are different from ourselves strengthen us, complete us, and even proudly define us as a community. We deserve to feel that powerful bond between brothers in arms who share the same workplace and the same purpose, striving for the collective good of our families while strengthening the community we share. We deserve to know that we can happily invest our best efforts without fearing that our accomplishments and individual worth will be overshadowed by our gender, color, or beliefs, and that we can be confident that we are judged on our merits alone, free of any bias. We deserve to feel safe, supported, and cared for at the place we spend most of our waking hours without fear of harassment, bullying, or mistreatment. We deserve to work in workplaces that cater to our emotional needs as much as our physical needs, organizations that respect and demand of us a reasonable work-life balance. Our families deserve that we start fighting for it now. And we can actually achieve this within a few years if we open our workplace doors wide, inviting all those who were previously kept out to join us, and then help them to integrate well, remain inside, and thrive. But the rub is that we currently have two important hurdles situated at the workplace entrance, rendering a large group of people unable to join us, no matter how widely we open the doors. I'll explain. Hurdle 1, bias and prejudice. Diversity, equity, and inclusion, DE&I, has become a mainstream and popular topic in the workplace. Yet, in the United States, most people with disabilities, 15% of the population, are unemployed and greatly underrepresented at the same organizations that proudly host seminars and write op-eds on inclusion. Is it a lack of ability Or is it prejudice that's keeping people with disabilities, ex-felons and others out? It's 100% the latter. For example, minorities as a group obviously don't lack ability, but they still need to send in twice as many applications as mainstream people do just to get an interview. Prejudice is constantly turning potentially contributing members of our society into financial and welfare burdens by keeping them out of the workplace, and that same prejudice then blames them for their absence from the workplace by regarding them as welfare burdens to society. That's one challenge we will need to overcome when setting our sights on full inclusion. Hurdle 2, feeling unsafe. Even if we wanted to enable full inclusion in the workplace, most current workplaces lack a basic accommodation, the second hurdle, that keeps out many of those trying to get in. This missing accommodation would be easier to see and appreciate if it were a physical one like a ramp, but it's not. It's an emotional accommodation, hence the difficulty in spotting it. But it's as effective at keeping people out of the workplace as it is at lowering the productivity, engagement and work well-being of many of those currently in it. Our workplaces need to become emotionally healthy and safe for the people working there, and alas, they are far from it. Here are some upsetting stats for you. Regrettably, the modern workplace holds its employees' feelings in very little regard, with over 50% of US employees feeling unhappy at their jobs. Even worse, the modern workplace is a literal hotbed of bullying, with 66% of Americans reporting having been bullied at work, while a Glassdoor survey reveals that 61% of US employees have personally witnessed or experienced discrimination in the workplace. As we shall see, harassment, bias, and bigotry are deeply embedded in our workplace culture, neglecting the very thing that makes us human, our emotions. Even though the modern workplace goes to great lengths to cater to people's physical needs, it does a remarkably poor job when it comes to their emotional needs. Being shouted at and belittled by a superior causes much emotional pain, and it's always awful. And the fact that it might happen while you're sitting in a tastefully decorated meeting room is of little consolation. So, too, does being sexually harassed or bullied cause much emotional pain, even if it occurs on the way to the lavish corporate cafeteria or the new ice cream machine. You might have noticed yourself that many employers usually neglect to flag being harassed or being publicly humiliated in their work contracts as potentially damaging work hazards. There are many among us who cannot psychologically tolerate the cold, uncaring, and at times violent and cruel corporate culture that has all too often become the norm, and they are consequently de facto barred from the workplace by a large emotional barrier. In fact, some CEOs are worshipped in the media as folk heroes for their innovative companies and products, while their bullying, harassing and at times actual cruelty to their colleagues are known but overlooked or intentionally covered up. Since when do individuals' talents entitle them to treat all the people around them like dirt while causing untold human emotional suffering? Did these people's job descriptions say, ability to inflict emotional stress and abuse, a must? Social justice in the workplace will be achieved when large corporations' workforces accurately represent the true diversity of the communities in which they're based. Corporations need to stop talking the talk of inclusion and need to start walking the walk by opening their doors to all unemployment underdogs. Defining employment underdogs. The term underdog is American and originates from 19th century dogfights. The winning dog was called the top dog, and the loser or expected loser was called the underdog. In modern times, the term underdogs usually refers to those who are predicted to lose in a struggle or contest for one of two reasons: because they are initially deemed as lesser, or because they are victims of injustice or persecution. I define employment underdogs as those who have to work harder than mainstream people when it comes to finding a job, getting it, keeping it, and succeeding at it in order to enjoy the same success, regardless of their personal merits. Employment underdogs as a group are no lesser than others in any regard, other than the opportunities they are afforded in the workplace. Many groups and individuals fall into the category: single mums, religious minorities, victims of injustice, people who are viewed as different from the mainstream, people with a different sexual orientation, people with a different ethnicity, people with low self-confidence, ex-cons and felons, and basically anyone who feels self-doubt regarding their current capacity to fit in and succeed in the workplace. Researchers have found that 50% of interviewers think that candidates can be eliminated from consideration due to the way they dressed, acted, or walked through the door. Companies place a premium on people who are confident, perform well under stress, learn quickly, and are capable of leaving all of their life problems at the door to the office. Looking and dressing well, having the right accent, and commanding great people skills are also highly regarded. People who are different, slower, less confident, and less attractive are less sought after, less chosen when screened, and less catered to during onboarding and day-to-day operations. When it comes to the workplace, they are often considered underdogs, or in their minds, they feel like underdogs. In brief, underdogs are a very large group of people who, in the workplace, are often confronted with various degrees of prejudice, and they feel or are often viewed as slightly or greatly less likely to succeed. Employment underdog disclaimer. Many employment underdogs are unaware of the added difficulties they face in the workplace. They don't regard themselves as such, nor are they even aware of their underdog status. Underdogs can be amazingly talented and successful, and they can even feel superior and act with annoying hubris. You wouldn't necessarily know that you are earning less than your male counterpart because of your gender, or that you were not invited for an interview because of your ethnicity. My definition has nothing to do with actual merit, capabilities, or success. But whether they realize it or not, most members of non-mainstream groups don't enjoy a level playing field in the workplace, and for some, this disadvantage is enough to keep them chronically unemployed with dire implications. Unemployment is a trunk from which many branches of unhappiness emerge. Poverty, lack of purpose and dignity, low self-worth, loneliness, isolation, and often, loss of hope. What true diversity means. Workforces that represent the true diversity of their communities means, for instance, the following. People with disabilities constitute 15% of the population. Some people with disabilities are institutionalized and are unable to work. However, the vast majority of people with disabilities can and should work. Correspondingly, people with disabilities should constitute at least 10% of the workforce, not 3% or less, as they do today in the United States. Similarly, other underdog groups should be represented in the workforce in very similar proportions in which they exist in the community and the greater society. Furthermore, in order that everybody find a place in the modern-day workplace, including the shy, the anxious, or the emotionally challenged, opening doors will not be enough. In order to knock down the existing emotional barriers, workplaces should become safe places of social caring. I will argue that we evolved as a species to work within our tribe, with a strong sense of belonging and in a caring environment where everybody contributes. The fact that so many of us, rich and poor, are depressed, anxious, or generally unhappy is because we are social animals. We function best when provided with the daily human warmth that 200,000 years of hunting and gathering within a caring, close-knit tribe got us used to. The same daily human warmth and caring that's so sorely lacking at many of our places of work. Tribes and families are not devoid of fighting, arguing, and shouting, but these feel totally different when you know that at the end of the day, you are regarded and cared for as an individual. In short, social justice in the workplace will be achieved when corporate America and other workplaces actively strive for full inclusion and change their current emotionally detached culture to one of human warmth and caring. The question is, how can such a change transpire? What are the stepping stones we need to traverse? Is this change practical or even possible? What can each of us do to facilitate the process? How this book is organized? In order to answer these questions in the most granular and practical form possible, I've divided this book into three parts. Part 1, the current realities and future benefits of diversity, equity, and inclusion. In Part 1, I'll describe the current state of affairs regarding DE&I, and I'll prove that corporate America is far from upholding the same values they publicly claim to deeply believe in and endeavor to live up to. You might be surprised how widely their talk and their walk differ and how large their hypocrisy is. I'll detail the huge financial, social, and individual gains to be had if we succeed at making full inclusion in the workplace a norm, and I will detail the work that large corporations, which typically tout their corporate and social responsibility, CSR investments, must do to actually get us there. The global Fortune 500 have a combined yearly CSR budget of, wait for it, a staggering $20 billion. I'll tell you how they utilize it regarding the employment of the world's overlooked underdogs. You might get upset. To prove that underdogs have as much ability as anyone else, I'll introduce you to a company founded purely in order to serve as a showcase, a proof of concept regarding underdog talent. It is perhaps the only free market for-profit company out there that is staffed and managed entirely by people from some of the most overlooked and chronically unemployed underdog groups. People you need to hear about, whose heroics inspire, educate and amaze while laying to rest any doubts you might have regarding the practicality of wanting everyone to successfully find and keep a job. Part 2, Underdog Challenges and Remedies. In Part 2, I'll describe how corporate America's current culture of disregarding people's emotional needs is keeping many employees out and making many of those who do work miserable. I'll explain how employees' emotions should be regarded throughout their employment life cycle and why it is important to do so. I'll introduce you to a new human resource entity that can greatly contribute to employees' sense of community, and I'll provide new, granular, and easy-to-use insights and recommendations regarding screening, training, and onboarding that call into question the relevance of some widely practiced traditional procedures. I'll explain why the most important term in management is absurdly the one least mentioned in managerial theory and practice. I'll prove that abusing power in the workplace has reached epidemic dimensions, and I'll describe the terrible effect such abuse has on more than 50% of US employees. I'll detail the psychological processes that transform people who were initially warm and caring into cold, unempathetic, and at times abusive managers. And I'll explain why power abuse is in general so widespread and so impervious to change. And finally, I'll explain how workplace harassment and abuse can, in effect, be significantly curtailed, and where such efforts have been previously successful. If you have ever been harassed, belittled, or bullied at work, most have, you might be awarded some clarity, and hopefully comfort, from understanding the psychology involved. Part 3, Getting From Here to There. After covering what specifically must change in our workplaces, how, why, and by whom, in Part 3 I'll acquaint you with the concept of reserved employment for the opportunity deprived, REOT. I will introduce you to a large and truly amazing company that is far ahead of the rest of the corporate world in achieving actual diversity, equity, inclusion, and social responsibility. Far, far ahead. I'll then describe what you and every person who really craves social justice can do to help get us there. It's not a big ask at all, and it's well within people's comfort zones. Power doesn't just reside in the workplace. It also resides within us as individuals, family members, and friends, and it's time we collectively harnessed it. We need to stand behind the core value described in the US Declaration of Independence, upheld by the Charters of the United Nations and the European Union, the one about everyone's equality and unalienable rights. Throughout, I'll present a plethora of academic studies, surveys, and factoids that validate my claims, together with practical proof designed to convince you that at long last, we have a real opportunity to make significant inroads towards social justice as long as we combine our efforts and focus them on the workplace. It will make all our lives better, richer, and healthier, and it will save countless lives and end much human suffering and misery. This book is about the road we should take and the part people need to play in order to get us there. I have dedicated the last 20 years of my life preparing arguments, collecting research, and literally building proof, trying to eliminate any reason or excuse anyone might have for hesitation or uncertainty regarding full inclusion. We have everything we need to win this fight, and now is the time to start it. Everyone loves a good underdog story, right? You'll be hearing a few you've never heard before. I have always believed that all humans are born with equal rights. I have always believed that the strength of communities is measured by the treatment they afford their weakest, and I believe many share these beliefs. The road to social justice starts in the workplace. It's a battle for our excluded brother and sister humans, as well as for our own emotional health and well-being. It's a battle we can and shall win with Underdogs. Part 1. The current realities and future benefits of diversity, equity, and inclusion. 1. Diversity, equity, and inclusion. Corporate America's biggest con job. Only 3.2% of companies on the Fortune 500 list release the race and gender data of their employees. Inclusion has become a trendy word when it comes to the workplace. Most large companies have inclusion officers. Many publish articles about their inclusion practices, and diversity, equity, and inclusion, DE&I, is all the rage in HR research and popular publications nowadays. Amazon sells over 4,000 books under the diversity and inclusion topic alone, many written in just the past few years. Any supporter of DE&I should be filled with optimism at the stellar rise in popularity the idea of inclusion in the workplace seems to be enjoying. And yet the current use of the term inclusion is highly problematic, and I fear that in practice, it actually serves to foster the opposite, exclusion. The Cambridge Dictionary defines inclusion as the act of including someone or something as part of a group. According to this definition, if a large theoretical company had no black or brown people working for them at all, and they decided to hire a few black people, but not brown people, they would be considered inclusive. After all, they are including some black people as part of their group, albeit while continuing to leave brown people out. Viewing these efforts, black people and others might think that this theoretical company is inclusive. Look, they're opening their doors to people of color. But in fact, this theoretical company is operating with pure prejudice and bias. They continue their practice of barring their doors to certain groups just because of their race and ethnicity or their background or beliefs. They continue to disregard people's personal merits and capabilities, and they judge applicants mainly according to the group they belong to. They've just stopped doing it to black people. In this example, it's easy to see that this theoretical company doesn't practice inclusion at all. Rather, they practice the complete opposite, exclusion. It takes a lot of people to successfully exclude. If you think about it, exclusion needs to run deep in order for it to become a company-wide phenomenon. Many HR people and managers throughout the company need to share and/or act upon the same core biases and beliefs regarding certain groups in order for it to succeed. It necessitates extensive shared prejudice that must be rooted in the corporate culture. I'll illustrate. Imagine that a large company decides that they wish to minimize the number of Muslim employees. What would that company need to do in order to successfully limit the number of Muslim applicants and new employees? They would need to possess a company culture that accepted silent undercurrents of exclusion and bias toward Muslim individuals. The bias undercurrents wouldn't need to be strong at all. Subtle cues conveying satisfaction when hiring mainstream applicants as opposed to indifference when hiring Muslims would be enough to gradually increase Muslim exclusion. Some HR people might have ingrained prejudice toward Muslim individuals, but many others will flow with the company's unspoken preferences. Without such company-wide exclusion undercurrents and subtle cues, some HR people might just go ahead and mistakenly hire Muslims who seem to have potential. In corporate America, exclusion is seldom an individual's preference or folly. Rather, it's institutionalized, that is, it's in the culture. For a large company to have very few black people or women in senior positions, or very few ex-cons or very few immigrants working for them, it takes the tacit coordination of many people in the company. It requires an exclusive company undertone and culture that encourages hiring mainly from mainstream groups rather than from minority groups. Similarly, to have women significantly underrepresented in senior management entails active, widespread, but often unspoken misogyny. Get rid of the bouncer. Understanding the dynamics of inclusion. To achieve real social justice in the workplace, for corporate America to become truly inclusive, including some one or some groups, isn't good enough. We have to include everyone and all groups. In the past few years, various companies have tried to convince us of the sincerity of their inclusion efforts by opening their doors to specific groups. Unfortunately, we're hiring black people, or we're promoting women, or we just opened our gates to this or that group, just serves to punctuate and consolidate exclusion. By allowing companies to focus their inclusion efforts on one group at a time, while leaving their doors barred to others, we are actively legitimizing the practice of excluding various groups and individuals from the workplace. You either judge people on their own individual merits, or you judge them based on the group they belong to or the place they hail from. If you act upon the latter and exclude anyone based on the group they belong to, then it's totally irrelevant which precise group it is that you're excluding. It still makes you biased and your actions prejudiced and exclusive. It's just like stealing, and even if you're stealing from only one group, it's still stealing. And it makes the transgressor a thief. To put it simply, you can't have a bouncer at the door selecting who gets in and who doesn't, and claim to be inclusive and diverse, even if you start to limit the bouncer's list of undesirables. You are either inclusive, have no bouncer, and welcome everyone based on personal merit, or you are exclusive and your bouncers keep certain people out just because of the group they belong to, disregarding completely who they are as individuals. The identity and variety of the excluded is irrelevant. In this sense, all lives matter, and no one deserves to be harassed. A corporation is either fully inclusive or it's exclusionary. There is no such thing as partial inclusion, and as long as any one group is excluded from a workplace, that workplace is in actuality exclusive. For a corporation to regard itself as inclusive, it must be fully inclusive. I define full inclusion as accepting everyone other than two groups of people. One, people who are actively paying the price for their crimes and are currently incarcerated, and two, people whose physical or mental condition is so severe that they are institutionalized and need constant caretaking. The rest of the members of our societies globally deserve a place in the job market because deeming any group or members of our society as unworthy, unable, unnoticed, or undeserving is the literal opposite of social justice. And it sure as hell isn't inclusion. Because I wish to promote a global change regarding the diversity and culture of our workplaces, and before I answer the questions of what changes are needed and how we can achieve them, let's examine the why. Why should corporate America, our communities, and ourselves be highly motivated and committed to this change? Is it really worth our collective efforts? Diversity is great for maximizing profit. Achieving full inclusion in the workplace is a huge social undertaking because when you look at the DE&I data that is available, much isn't, you'll see so many workplaces that obviously hold biases towards certain groups who are markedly underrepresented in their workforce. Any corporation wishing to change such widespread prejudice will face a lengthy battle that will demand enormous effort, grit, and perseverance. Many challenges and objections need to be faced and overcome, and many preconceptions and biases need to be addressed and put to rest. It truly is an immense task, and its undertaking will demand serious motivation and commitment to see it through. Social justice might be a strong enough motivator when it comes to the currently unemployed and their families who crave inclusion, but they aren't the ones who need to undergo profound change. That's the job of large corporations and employers. And for that to be contemplated in a capitalistic profit-driven economy, it's crucial that the financial benefit to employers justify the immense efforts required. After all, we are basically asking employers to forego their hiring strategy of searching only for the best and brightest mainstream candidates, and instead we're asking them to become fully diverse. Often that will entail hiring people who look different, come from different backgrounds, or have been afforded lesser schooling. Some might come in at an initial lower level of performance or with weaker initial capabilities. Some might even be difficult to employ for various reasons and need various accommodations. This is an ask that does seem to go against sound financial reason because, after all, the more uniform people are, the easier it is to train and manage them. Can diversity in any way be congruent with maximizing profits? Is it really financially worth their while? Well, happily, full inclusion and employee diversity turns out to be great for business, while neglecting diversity efforts could actually be akin to playing with fire, and it could cause company profits to suffer an excruciating third-degree burn. Why full inclusion greatly facilitates a company's bottom line? There are three main factors that will deeply and positively affect organizations that choose the full inclusion route: elevated consumer support, elevated employee engagement, and lowered employee attrition. It's quite shocking what a huge impact on an organization's bottom line these three can have. It can literally make or break them. Consumer power and support. Consumers over the years have always had the ability to vote with their feet, wallet, and with the rise of the internet and social media, consumers can now also greatly influence what other people buy. Correspondingly, in the past few years, Many consumers developed a growing sensitivity to social issues and began advocating for corporations and products that register high on matters of social justice while punishing transgressors. As a result, more and more people are using the internet not only to uncover the true worth of a company's products, but also to uncover the true worth of the company's values and social responsibilities. The 2018 Edelman Earned Brand Global Report found that 47% of consumers in the United States were belief-driven buyers, meaning that they choose, switch, avoid, or boycott a brand based on its stand on social issues. 1 year later, in 2019, the number of belief-driven buyers in the United States rose to 59%, a 25% increase in just 1 year. Similar trends are underway in many other countries. Given the rise of belief-driven consumers, any corporation that is forthcoming and fully transparent regarding the makeup of its workforce and that proudly boasts a team that truly reflects the diversity of the community will garnish tremendous consumer support. And the more positive benchmarks of this kind consumers have, the more they will punish businesses that are not transparent or inclusive. Corporations worldwide are learning that various social injustices that they could get away with not so many years ago are nowadays more noticeable and are unacceptable in the eyes of many of their customers. Clearly, we're in the age of belief-driven buyers, and brands that don't factor in social issues accordingly do so at their own peril. In fact, brands know this, and most put much effort into trying to look the part by publicly applauding DE&I values and spotlighting their relevant inclusion efforts. Employee engagement. There are many definitions of employee engagement, but in essence, it speaks about how employees feel emotionally at their work and the amount of effort they are willing to put in over the long term. The higher employees' engagement, the more productive, loyal, and caring about their workplace they will be. The reason employee engagement has become such a crucial metric for organizations is financial. The differences in productivity and profits between organizations that have high employee engagement and those with low employee engagement is no less than dramatic. Gallup's 10th employee engagement meta-analysis examined employee engagement and performance data from more than 100,000 teams to evaluate the connection between employee engagement and key business outcomes. When compared with business units in the bottom quartile of engagement, those in the top quartile realized improvements in the following areas: 41% reduction in absenteeism, 17% increase in productivity, 10% increase in customer ratings, 20% increase in sales, 21% greater profitability. Gallup summarized the importance of employee engagement to a corporation's bottom line as follows. Simply put, engaged employees produce better business outcomes than other employees do. Across industries, company sizes and nationalities, and in good economic times and bad. DE&I efforts have been proven to raise employee engagement and have a wide positive effect in this regard because in order to become fully inclusive and succeed at employing underdogs, most of an employer's current employees will need to become part of their overall inclusion efforts. Inclusion demands building a culture of equality as well as much employee coordination. As we saw, the similar ingredients are needed for successful exclusion. Consequently, many existing employees will be needed to actively participate in the organization's social responsibility efforts. When the rank and file have an active part in these efforts, their own investment of energy in the welfare of the less fortunate will create both happiness, being kind to others promotes happiness, and a deeper sense of community and belonging, which in turn will promote their own sense of security. After all, if my employer is investing so much caring and effort in order to employ underdogs from the community, then they are obviously caring employers and will put in the same effort for me. Perhaps even more importantly, such endeavors add a deep sense of social purpose to organizations that don't intrinsically have one. Financial institutions, for instance, all of which greatly contribute to employees' overall engagement.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.